believe Jesus is God and he doesn't believe Jesus is God. He believes Jesus is his brother in prophethood. He believes this. So that contradicts me as if I put myself in your shoes. Now that's why we need to search objectively about the truth. That's why we need to search, me and you. We need to sit down, or if I'm in your place, I will sit down. I need to search objectively. I will say to you, well, hold on a second. I don't want to be not a Muslim, not a Christian. Let me just search objectively. Was this man saying the truth or not? Simple as that. Was this man a prophet and messenger of God? Was he sent by God, or was he just
using
only?
Kind of our general reasoning.
Yeah, all this reasoning we need to understand, and then after that, if we establish this, and then we'll take to the next point.
Isn't it rather strange and kind of unhelpful that the Quran comes? The major reason why at the time of Muhammad's ministry, he says Jews and Christians should believe in him because he's in the Torah and the Gospel. The Quran is very clear on that. That's why they're so hard-hearted, so rebellious for not understanding him. Yet that, in the vast sweep of history, that only really applies to a very few Jews and Christians in Arabia with the true Gospel, the true Torah. And it's very misleading and very unhelpful for all the other Jews and Christians throughout history who have the Torah and the Gospel that just don't talk about Muhammad, especially not in a clear fashion as we recognize our own sons. That's quite unhelpful and confusing from God's final message.
Okay. I will tell you now, and the answer to your question is, again, repeating the same answer as I just wanted to repeat. Now, we have as well some another evidences of the time of Muhammad, peace be upon him, not necessarily in Arabia. Now, the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent letters to the kings of his time. Yeah, he didn't stop by his time, by only the people in the Arabia. He literally, he sent a letter to Heracl or Caesar, the king of the Romans. He sent as well a letter to the Persian king. He sent a letter to the Abyssinian king. He sent letters to the people. The Abyssinian king has accepted Islam. Yeah, so he has accepted Islam according to the sources that we have. Yeah, maybe.
I thought he was hospitable to the Muslims. I didn't realize he converted.
No, he converted to Islam, and he converted to Islam, and he accepted Islam. And even we have furthermore that he died in a non-Muslim land, in a Christian land, and he was buried with a Christian sermon. And then Gabriel came to the Prophet ﷺ and said to him, go pray on your brother, because he accepted Islam, but he hid his belief as he will be, you know, the consequence he doesn't want to face. So which means someone from Abyssinia has accepted Islam. For him, it was sufficient evidence for him to accept Islam. Another story, that is as well Caesar of the king of the of the Rome.
I know the story.
You know the story. So he came, he was the Prophet, and he sent him a letter. He wanted to know who is this. Yeah. And he has the knowledge of the scripture that he has. He said the king of the circumcised one. So he knew there is someone from the circumcised one. He used to think the last one or the last prophet will be from the Jews. That's how he's thinking. Okay. Because the Christians, they don't circumcise, and then the Jews. And then suddenly a letter came to him. He said, I'm the final messenger. Then he said, Who was this person? And then he said, Is this person which is from the circumcised people, which is the descendants of Ismail?
Muhammad was not circumcised.
Okay,
clearly the true Torah and the Gospel is not just in Arabia.
Muhammad was not circumcised.
It's in Persia.
Yeah, by the way,
he talked about Jews and Christians.
I think
about Jews and Christians. So I have a right to speak that Muhammad was not circumcised even. Muhammad was not circumcised even. So can you prove that Muhammad was circumcised?
Can you get lost? Can you get lost?
Why?
Get lost.
Why you are speaking against Christianity?
Get lost.
Why you are speaking against Christianity?
I don't want to talk to you.
Why you are speaking against Christianity?
You are a hate preacher. I don't talk to
hate preachers. No. You are a hate preacher here.
Okay.
You are a hate preacher here.
Okay.
You are saying
I am in my territory.
Christians were not circumcised.
Yeah. Okay, let's continue.
Those people
they are here, as you know, they that's what they do. They hate the preacher. Those people, if you know, do you know this guy that who killed Muslims last year in New Zealand? The guy, the Christchurch. It is the effort of this guy and Hatun.
How can you talk about
he used to listen to them. And then he came to a mosque. He killed Muslims. He killed 51 people. And, oh no. No, no, so let's continue.
I was about to respond. So the true Torah in the Gospel is not just in Arabia, right? Salman, the Persian learned by
exactly.
Persia,
Heraclius. Now let's go to the question, which is about you. How come you, as after all this time, where I don't find, for example...
And even more than that, because all the historical evidence that we have, we have the Dead Sea Scrolls, we have the Torah long before Muhammad's coming, we have the entire New Testament centuries before Muhammad's coming. So if the true Torah in the Gospel exists outside of Arabia, how does Allah expect us to believe that when all of the manuscript evidence goes against it?
Now, the other thing, which goes, when Allah has said in the Quran, for example, when I said to you, for example, that the verse in the Bible, or the verse in the Bible talks about, for example, Muhammad, which is in the Hebrew, when the people, they read in the Hebrew, they said Muhammadin, for example. These ones, it could be that could be the evidence which is preserved to now. Now, that could be, I'm not saying it is, that could be the evidence which is for people now. But now, for us, we need to think again objectively from the thing. You and us, for example, you agree there will be a prophet will be coming. Do you know or not?
I agree there will be a prophet who's coming.
Yeah.
Not after Jesus.
Not after Jesus, okay. Now, do you know that he's going to be a fighter as well? Is he going to be a fighter? Someone who's going to be a fighter? Someone going to be, he's going to succeed against his enemy.
Surah 111 would suggest so, but...
Yeah, which is, not Surah 9, I'm talking about the Gospels. I'm talking about the Gospel. Okay. Is he going to be a fighter, this one? Was Jesus a fighter?
Jesus wasn't a fighter.
Okay, so now the Bible is talking about a fighter, a prophet who's a fighter, will be coming, and then he will make his enemy, he will defeat his enemy with his power. 1 second, since we are talking about that. Call Mansoor or one of the brothers, Mansoor or Hashim, because I need to do, I don't have, call Hashim, please call Hashim from there. Hashim! Can you come please a minute? Okay.
We can pick this up.
Yeah, okay.
Time,
okay, now it was described, yeah, Hashim. Where is the verse that talks about the verse in the Bible? The verse in the Bible that talks about the final or the a messenger or a prophet will be coming and who will be a fighter. One of his characteristics will be
Isaiah 42.
Okay, read please Isaiah 42.
Unfortunately, I left my Bible at home. I have to get on my phone.
I will read.
Please,
Isaiah 9,
read Isaiah 42.
Anyway,
if you are participating with him, I will tell you something. We will be not talking to you. If you are participating with the hate preachers, we will be not talking to you.
I don't know this guy.
Please, I'm addressing you the question, and I want you to speak.
Yeah, that's fine. I'm just getting Isaiah 42.
Good. That's it. Read, please.
So, just load it. Okay, Isaiah 42.
Yes.
I'll read the NIV, why not?
Yes.
Yes. Here is my servant whom I uphold,
yes.
My chosen one in whom I delight.
Yes.
I will put my spirit on him and he will bring justice to the nation.
Good.
He will not shout or cry out or raise his voice in the street.
One second. He will be not shout, yeah? Okay. And what?
He will not shout or cry out.
Well, he will not shout or cry out. Do you know that as well, this mission in the Quran exactly about the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam?
So I know this is very popular in Muslim tradition that this applies
continue.
To. A bruised reed he will not break, and a smouldering wick he will not snuff out. In faithfulness he will bring forth justice.
Okay.
He will not falter or be discouraged.
So,
till he establishes justice on earth, he will establish his teaching, the islands will put their
hope. Okay, continue.
And that's the end of kind of that section, although... this is part of the same section. I'll keep reading. This is what God the Lord says. The creator of the heavens who stretches them out, who spreads out the earth with all that springs from it, who gives breath to his people and life to those who walk on it. I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness. I will take hold of your hand. I will keep you and I will make you to be a covenant for the people and a light for the Gentiles, to open eyes that are blind, to free captives from prison, and to release from the dungeon those who sit in darkness.
Continue.
So that's the end of that bit about this coming servant.
Okay, so this servant,
and
so
please
do not participate.
Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6.
Bye-bye, you talk too much and you do little. Anyway, so here it says bring justice, and he says as well he will be a fighter. So Jesus wasn't a fighter.
Where was it fighter, sorry? Did I miss
Jesus wasn't a fighter.
It is further down.
Further down still. Yeah, go.
I've not looked up this verse.
Okay.
Look here. It says,
we don't want to listen. That's nonsense.
For unto us a son is born.
You say that
the government shall be upon his shoulders.
Let's do it another time.
You see here, Counselor,
when we wanted to have,
God,
when we wanted to have,
Father.
When we wanted to have,
that is Isaiah.
Listen,
that is Isaiah.
When,
that is Isaiah.
Yeah,
it's talking about Jesus.
Yeah.
Same book.
Fine.
Same book is talking about Jesus.
We believe in Jesus for your information.
Same book is talking about Jesus.
We don't deny. We are Jews. We are Muslims.
You should believe this, that he is of God Almighty.
Yeah.
He is God Almighty.
Yeah, the Kedar, yeah.
Jesus
the
village
of the Bible.
Yeah,
that's true. Now Isaiah.
Now here,
further down, it says about that he is.
Okay, so Dan, are you thinking of verse 13?
Continue.
Assuming you're thinking of verse 13. The Lord will march out like a champion. Like a warrior, he will stir like a warrior.
Exactly.
With a shout, he will
like a champion or a warrior, yeah?
And will triumph over his enemies.
So he has enemy, he will fight his enemies, yes?
So he's a warrior.
So he's a warrior, and he will fight his enemies, yes?
So two things, if I may, very quickly.
Thank you, Sister Elizabeth.
First of all, the reason,
and as well, this is which verse? This one.
This is
Isaiah 42. Yeah, and here this is the villages of the Kedar inhabits, and here the inhabits of the Selah. That's the one which is the verse I was talking about before, which is the Selah one. That the Isaiah here 11. He's talking about exactly. He's talking about Kedar. Listen. All this together. Kedar
is
one thing. Selah. And talking about a king or a leader who's gonna be a warrior as later on. All of these verses, it does not indicate about Muhammad.
Okay, I'm asking you. Shall I get my answer? Yeah, you're asking me. Fantastic. Okay. So first of all, the reason I didn't read out those later verses, initially, is because I'm not actually sure if they're part of the same section. I'm gonna have to look this up.
Yes.
See if they're part of what the scholars call the servant songs.
That's fine.
Because after verse 9, at least here, I've got a different subsection, Song of Praise to the Lord, which makes sense. Verse 10, you might have a shift there. Sing to the Lord a new song. So what's going on? What's Isaiah kind of 40 onwards about?
Okay, good.
It's generally thought to be about the return of the Jews from exile.
So,
I'm not actually sure this is
listen,
about
listen,
the
servant, let's, let me, let me,
to finish my answer, yeah. If I may. Even assuming it is, what is the point? Why is Kedar, Arabia, Kedar is mentioned sometimes in the Bible. It's normally mentioned, look this up, to demonstrate the extent to which good news will spread, which is the reason why earlier it begins in verse 10. Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise from the ends of the earth.
Yeah.
You who go down to the sea and all that lives it, the islands and all who live in them, let the wilderness and its towns raise their voices
for
a settlement where Kedar
lives.
A new song. What does a new song?
Because
what does a new song mean?
Muhammad never sang a new song.
What's the new song mean?
I think you know what you should listen. Why didn't you
read? By the way, what's your name? Your name is James? What's his name?
For every verse, no, it's Richard.
Richard.
Every verse, if you said, I have to look into it, then maybe it's best if you actually read it, research it, and then come. But I would actually give you this this link. So go to Many Prophets, One Message, and I think it's, if you look for the prophecy of, just look for Isaiah 42.
So basically,
says, the title is Muhammad, peace be upon him,
so do you think
and
this
Medina
is
in the Bible.
One second. Listen to this. Richard. I assume, this is what generally we assume with the people, that they are genuine.
That's the title.
Yeah? Listen, Richard.
Yeah, sorry, I'm listening, I'm just typing this.
Try to focus on this.
What he does is he actually analyzes each verse of Isaiah 42 and gives you the context and the relation between we believe that is a prophecy.
Maybe Deuteronomy 18.
Okay.
Muhammad, no one else.
Now going back, Richard. Now we are, since we assume generally, when we talk to a person newly, you know, this is the first time I'm discussing with you, we generally assume that you are genuine. That's what we assume. Yeah? Unless if you prove vice versa. I hope you do not prove. My advice to you, if you keep hanging with these guys, we will assume vice versa.
I'm not hanging.
I'm just saying to you and indicating to you how we do. Now we said to you, since I will advise you, go and read Isaiah from the beginning and then read from there.
One second. Chapter 9, verse 6.
Now what happened? Now in Isaiah, he's talking about Kedar. And we know now Kedar is one of the descendants of Ishmael. And Kedar, why I mentioned this Kedar and I keep emphasizing this. Kedar was representing the descendants of Ishmael. Arabs are three types. This is all the historians. Arabs are three types. One Arabs, all of them been destroyed. None of them is still alive. Like the people of Saleh, the people of Lut, they are destroyed. None of them left. None of them is alive. The second type of Arab, which they call Al-Arab Al-Arabah, which is the original Arabs. Those from the Qahtani, which they came from Yemen. They are descendants of Qahtani or from Yemen. They came and they were spread amongst the Arab Peninsula. Some of them settled particularly in Medina, in Yathrib. Yeah? So none of the descendants of Qaidar stayed in Medina before Muhammad. So it was known Al-Aws, Al-Khazraj and the Jews. Those are Al-Aws, Al-Khazraj, both of them. They are cousins, descendants of... That's, by the way, we have something in the Arab in traditions that we study, we call it Ilm al-Ansar, meaning the lineage. We study the lineage of the people. For example, I know my lineage all the way to my 14th grandfather and all the branches. We study this, yeah? So the Arabs, they know where exactly which is which and who's who, genealogy, yeah? So they know that the Aws and Khazraj, who settled in Medina, people of Medina, none of the descendants of Ishmael settled there. So the people who settled in Medina are people from Yemen originally. Those are Qahtani ones, the second type of the Arabs. The third type of the Arabs, they call Arab al-Mustamir. Those who became Arabs, originally, they are from the descendants of Ishmael. When Ibrahim, peace be upon him, when he traveled and he came to Mecca, and he left his son in a valley where nothing grows, and they stayed there until the water came. And after that, he learned a tribe of the Jurhum, which is from the Qahtani one, they settled in that area, and then he learned the Arabic from them. He didn't speak Arabic before. So he learned Arabic from them, then he became better than them in Arabic. This Ishmael, the son of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So he settled in Mecca. And then his descendants are the Arab, the third type of the Arabs, which is the Arabs who became Arabs. Yeah? Now Ismail alayhi salam, he was a messenger. Not just only, he was a prophet and messenger. So he continued to convey the message of Allah to the people. So that's why the people, the Arabs, they accepted Islam in his times. And then when Ibrahim alayhi salam came and they built Mecca, they built Kaaba, and then made the people.
A'udhu billah, what's this? Quraysh, they were pagan. A'udhu billah. And Muhammad is the one. First person who
received, you know, revelation. Unfortunately, revelation. You know, the good thing,
Muhammad,
listen, the good thing
all
that you Christian, you are not all the same. That's the good thing.
All
the Quran confirms this.
Even
some of the people
pagan,
of the book,
they
are
pagan.
Criminal like
they
him.
Pagan.
And
they
some
pagan.
People,
they
and some pagan. People, they are, you know, genuine like yourself.
Yeah.
So let me finish the point. Then the descendants of Ishmael, amongst the Arabs, they were considered to be called, either they call them Mudari, amongst the Arabs, they call them Mudari, meaning the Mudar, which is one of the descendants of Qaidar. In the outside the Arab Peninsula, they were called the Qaidari ones, because Qaidar is he's the oldest son of Ishmael. Like for example, nowadays you say this man is Saudi, not necessarily he is from the Saudi family. Yeah, not to say he's from the Saudi family, but he came from the area which is ruled by who? By Saudi family. You got it? So the same thing in the Arabs. So the Qaidar was leading in Mecca. So all the people was allowed around him. They used to be called Qaidari people. So the only link between Qaidar and Sela in Medina is one person, which is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he traveled and settled there.
Did Prophet Muhammad suffer on behalf of other people's sins?
What?
So scholars normally interpret the servant songs as being related to each other, right? Isaiah 42, Isaiah 49, Isaiah 52 to 53. So if your interpretation is correct, for what it's worth, you know, I have looked into Isaiah 42 line by line, didn't find it convincing to be Muhammad, but of course that was a long time ago, I'll do it again. But scholars normally interpret those together. And in Isaiah 52 to 53, it's very clear that this is an individual who suffers on behalf of other people. So do you think that's Muhammad?
Who suffers on behalf of
other people? Yeah, should we have a read?
Who suffers on behalf of other people?
Where is it in Isaiah 42?
Now,
who suffers on
Isaiah 52?
No, because you said this whole conversation is with regards to Isaiah 42. You said that all these three talk about a suffering servant. Where is it in Isaiah 42?
So I'm saying scholarship generally sees the servant songs, as they're called, as being linked, which I find plausible, because within a short period of time in Isaiah, you have in Isaiah 42, 49, 52, 53, reference to the servant.
Where is it in Isaiah 42, the suffering servant?
So it doesn't say explicitly it's the same person.
So it talks about a new song.
So
a
new song.
What is a new song?
What's the meaning of a new song?
In a short period of time within the Bible, if you've got the
listen, when you say a new song, what does it mean to you?
So as I said,
what does it mean to a new song?
It could either mean two Messiah things. This is either talking just about the redemption song of the Jews from exile, which is what a lot of scholars think Isaiah 39 onwards is about. Or this could be about the servant whom you're talking about.
But Jesus never fought. How come you're talking about a warrior? You're talking about, he's talking about, one second. No, he's not talking, about.
That is
how?
A biblical language when he talks, it means the Lord is with you. He's talking about someone who will defeat.
How, someone will defeat his enemies. How come Jesus didn't do that? Jesus never fought. Actually, according to the Christian, he was defeated.
And he never went to Kedah.
He never went. According to the Christian, he was literally, he was killed and defeated. Yeah? So that's why I will say to you, my brother, I will say to you,
would you like my response to that?
Open your mind and heart to accept the truth. Now, I understand that you live the, that's one of the things. But for me, that's not the only thing I will rely. I will say, open the Quran and read and study the Quran.
Okay.
So study the Quran and understand the Quran. What the Quran is focusing about, what the Quran is talking about, how the Quran described the Prophet, how a person literally suffered, was tortured, people, they tried to kill him, they accused him with all of these things. They're still evil people like this guy and other. They still they say bad things about him. All of these things. And yet, until all these 1400 years, and still yet, they would talk ill about him and talk bad about him. And what did he gain from this life? Did he, if he won kingship of his time, think about it objectively. If a person, the pagan, they offered him, they said, we're going to give you a king. We're going to make you the king. We're going to make you the richest one amongst us. We're going to give you such and such. Why did he refuse? And he lived poor and died poor with nothing in his act, nothing. Literally died poor. Alayhi salatu wasalam. Well, what did he get? And he didn't have even children to inherit, to give them whatever they have. What's the point to all of these things?
Muhammad back to and his gang.
Muhammad and his gang.
If I do read Isaiah 42 again very carefully, think it all through, and I'm not convinced, I just don't think it's Muhammad. Given that the Quran does seem to place a lot of weight on saying they'll recognize him clearly, do I then have an excuse before Allah?
It wasn't for everyone.
Just say,
Richard, it wasn't for everyone.
He has a good question. He said, do I have excuse before Allah to say, I didn't find a sufficient evidence to say this? No, I will tell you no. Do you know why? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said the hadith. He said, by Allah, by the one who's my soul in his hand. Yeah, no Jews or Christian hears about me, and he didn't accept what I was sent with, except Allah will put him in hellfire. Now you heard about him. Now it's your duty, I will say to you, it's your duty to study him, to know him, to understand him. Maybe you have to know him. Now that's why, through the right sources. Now instead, for example, if you want to listen to some hate preacher, people who are just only attacking him.
Let's not talk about hate preachers. Yeah. That's irrelevant.
Talk about, okay, good. So I will say, my advice to you, go and search and discover yourself. It's your own journey.
So Richard, if you think the prophecy is the only way to convince about Muhammad's existence, or the fact that he's a prophet of God, then that is the wrong way to approach it, That was a sign for the people in whose book it was written.
And can I...
my question to this gentleman earlier, I think before you arrived, was, given that the Quran says, you know, they'll find him in the Torah and the Gospel, they'll recognize him as free as they recognize their own sons.
They even recognize him, not you.
Right, okay, here's my question. And I asked the gentleman earlier. Is it not A, unhelpful, that should only apply to just Jews and Christians at that time period, 7th century Arabia, and not almost all Jews and Christians that are left, and B, misleading in that
why is it
Jews and Christians from other time periods pick up the Torah and the Gospel, and they say, I find nothing about Muhammad here. I especially don't recognize him as I recognize my own sons. So that makes me think the Quran is wrong.
Okay, so if you look at the evidence, the reason the Jews were actually in Medina, yes, far away from Israel, why do you think they were there?
So that's what this gentleman said, right?
Yeah.
So, the question then is, if there was a Torah and a Gospel, which did have clear descriptions of Muhammad, where is it? You know, we've got the Torah from before Muhammad's time, we've got lots of Gospels, complete New Testament, complete Old Testament, and there's no, unless Isaiah 42, unless I'm convinced, there's just no clear description of Muhammad.
Okay.
Because it's interesting, the text here, as you know, is mentioned.
There is another...
They describe the exact physical details of Muhammad.
There is another thing as well, I will add to your information as well. Since we're talking about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, now this verse was addressing certain people at that certain time. Now what about the pagan, which is the majority of the Muslims at that time, who used to be pagan and they accepted Islam? They didn't have any scriptures, they didn't have any all of these things. What made sense for them to accept Islam? So the Quran was not only addressing those ones and addressing you only. So the Quran is addressing everyone to look and to check and to find. So that's why I will say to you, now okay, the Quran is talking about this particular thing. Yeah. I will say to you, the Quran is not just only about that particular thing.
I agree.
There are other things in the Quran indicate about the prophethood of the Prophet ﷺ.
I agree.
So one of the things, for example, let me give you one single example in the Bible, which the Quran was right about it and the Bible was wrong about it.
Pharaoh.
Okay, in front of everyone. Seriously, in the Bible, what they describe the king at the time of Moses.
Joseph.
What was the title of the king at the time of Joseph?
From memory, the Bible calls it Pharaoh. Even though the historical records.
Good. And what's the king was called? What the king was called at the time of Moses? Pharaoh. The same. So they call the king at the time of Joseph was Pharaoh, and the king title at the time of Moses was Pharaoh. Both of them are the same. Now, is English guy like yourself? Not long time ago, who interpreted Rosetta Stone. Not long time ago, 100 years ago, nearly 100 years ago or so, yeah? When they found Rosetta Stone, which interpreted the old Hebrew language and the old Greek language into Latin, and from Latin, he understood, which is, sorry, the hieroglyphic language, interpreted into Greek, and that Greek interpreted into Latin. So what they have said, they discovered that the king of the time of Joseph, it's impossible to be called Pharaoh. In fact, Pharaoh was a title of the palace of the king, not the king himself. So how come a book which comes 500-600 years after Jesus and indicate that correcting a mistake was done before?
So there are times where the Quran, what you say, it's correcting. There are other times when the Quran seems to go along with error. That's a massive discussion that I don't want to spend all night.
Yeah.
On this very particular point. I accept, I've looked into it a little bit, and it does seem that the Bible is anachronistic in calling the first Pharaoh, right? Why does it do that? The explanation I can think of, and I've not checked any scholars on this, so I need to do that, is it's using later language in the same sense.
So you accept
when you speak to a generation, you speak in terms they understand, so you can use a later title to refer to an earlier thing.
No, you cannot say you cannot call the emperor of China as the king of China. He's emperor. It doesn't work.
The title doesn't work.
But also on the point about the house of Pharaoh, if that's so inappropriate, why does that get into the Firaun? Don't most scholars see Firaun as an Arabic version of Pharaoh?
Firaun is the Arabized way.
Right, but if Pharaoh is an inaccurate title, why is
even
Pharaoh
is English, you know that.
Pharaoh is English.
Whatever the Hebrew for Pharaoh is, which you object to, the hieroglyphic or whatever.
Now you're looking at semantics here. What we are looking at is the exact title, like
the title, let alone the title.
And the term Pharaoh, there's a significant difference. We are not talking about what the Arabs call the term Pharaoh.
And what the English is, how I pronounce it in English.
That is semantics, basically.
We're not talking about the title itself. Okay. The title itself. For example, I will say to you, for example, in English, for example, we say, you say Alexander, we say Al-Iskandar. Yeah, but that's how the Arab pronounce the thing.
That's fine, but that's...
The point is, the point is, we are talking about the title itself. The title was used, that title, Pharaoh, was used for the king at the time of Joseph, which is historically error and a mistake. And what about the Dead Sea scriptures? Why the Dead Sea scrolls didn't rectify it?
Okay, what was the other point?
You brought to me. You said to me, okay, one second. You said to me, they know about him. But in the Dead Sea scrolls, for example, we don't find the description of Muhammad. I will say to you the same thing using the same analogy. Why they didn't the Dead Sea scrolls? They didn't, you know, rectify. Rectify this title Pharaoh to say, but hold on a second, that's not Pharaoh, it's a king.
Because I'm not setting that as the standard.
Did you get it?
Right, I think the Quran is...
Did you get my point?
Earlier you were saying that there's also an issue about Pharaoh, it's an inappropriate title because it means like the house, not the person. What are you saying?
What I'm saying, when they discovered this Pharaoh at the time of the Joseph, this is what the history, what I read. This is what I read in that, but it's definitely, it's not, it used to be called a king. It wasn't called a pharaoh, basically, simple as that. He was called a king, the king of Joseph at the time. So he's a king, his title is a king. He wasn't pharaoh, wasn't nothing except a king. Now, this king, so pharaoh, it was said in the thing which I read, that it was said it is a description of the palace of the king. The castle of the king used to be called the pharaoh at that time.
Okay.
It was indication in a way. So the point is, again, so the Bible was mistaken in this thing, one thing. Plus as well, when you are using this analogy to say, for example, okay, but the Bible here, it didn't indicate about Muhammad, it wasn't describing it properly. I will say to you, even the Bible did not rectify a mistake in it, which is about, you know, description of the king. So that's one thing. And there is a lot. So my point is to you, we need to think and we need to study things objectively rather than to study it on, hold on a second, let's study it objectively. To say, study the biography of Muhammad, peace be upon him, understand him, know what he was called, what was the call of Muhammad. And as well, study, I will say to you, go back to the scriptures. Jesus never preached for the people to be worshipped. He never said to be worshipped. Or the Trinity. So, in the way, you cannot be more royal than the Queen. You cannot be more royal than the Queen. You cannot say, you know, Jesus saying to you, you know, the Father is greater than I. I was sent by you, by my Father, your Father, by God, your God. All of these things. No. He is the Lord. And by the way, there is a funny story, by the way, in this. We say there is two people walking in the desert, Two people walking in the desert. One of them, he saw something on the ground. And the other, he said, I saw something. The other guy, he said to him, that is a goat. He said to him, okay, let's walk further. So they were, he said, I could see it has feathers. It has feathers. Then the guy, he said to him, no, it's a goat, even if it has feathers. Some goats has feathers.
Sure.
Then they were saying, look, it has wings. It has wings. And it has beak. He said to him, no, some goats, they have... And then it starts flying. Yeah. Then the guy, you know what he said?
He said
it's a goat, even if it flies. So what? My point is to you, now you are saying, Jesus is God. He is saying to you, I am not the God. And you say, no, he's the God. He's saying to you, worship the Father, and I worship my Father. And you say, no, he's the God. You understand?
We'll have to discuss that another day. I need to go soon, because I've got a train to catch. But no before problem. I go... You were saying quite firmly in 2146, Surah Al-Baqarah 146, it's talking about Muhammad. Given that Tafsir has disagreed on this, given that translations today, so Muqatil ibn Sulayman, Tabari, the opinions they record.
Ibn Kathir.
What was the first one I said?
The Tafsir ibn Kathir, have you seen that?
I have probably looked it up at some point, but I focused on the early ones.
It actually specifically says it's Prophet Muhammad.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. So in some like Muqatil ibn Sulayman and Tabari, they record very early opinions, and these are much earlier than Ibn Kathir.
Tabari, doesn't matter if it's... Okay. Just because it's early, doesn't make
okay,
it right.
Fine.
You should
fine.
Know that. Some... Tabari has many mistakes, which the scholars have corrected.
Okay, fine.
But look at Ibn Kathir, and you'll know that these are the major...
All right, if you want to go with Ibn Kathir...
The language, it's indicated. The language itself.
Such as Hilal Khan, I was just reading a minute ago, well-respected, yeah? that it says either talking about the Kaaba, that the Qibla is towards the Kaaba,
the Qibla,
or Muhammad. So how, and given that, in my opinion, the context of verses 142 to 150 are all about the direction of prayer, why are you so certain that it is Muhammad, which is taught in other passages, I agree, but in this passage, how do you know it is Muhammad and not the direction
now,
of prayer,
now,
that they are directing?
Yeah, if you know how the Mufassirin,
there is,
I will give a bit fundamental principles in terms of tafsir. The tafsir, the scholars of tafsir, they will study the Quran and they do the tafsir, which means interpreting the Quran either through the Quran itself or through the hadith or through the language. Now, here it indicates here when Allah is talking about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then Allah said, يعرفونه كما يعرفون أبناءهم, which means they know him. يعرفونه, him.
No. Who can be him or it?
It, the masculine one, not the feminine one. Masculine it, not a feminine one.
Okay.
Why? Because otherwise Allah will say يعرفونها. Means if it's okay. Kaaba or Qibla, Qibla is feminine. Okay. If it's a feminine, even though it's objective.
If the Arabic is that clear, why didn't Muqatil ibn Sulayman or Tabari think so?
Now here, for me, these are doesn't contradict. Because for me, the indication, it indicates about the truthfulness of the Quran. That's mainly.
Okay.
So if you know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for example, if you know him, yeah. If Allah is talking about what is Shatr al-Masjid al-Haram, al-Masjid, it's talking about the Qibla Masjid. That's it's could be the Masjid as
right.
Some they said, not the Qibla.
Or the Haqq concerning the issue.
Could be the Haqq.
Could be that. Right, so grammatically it could fit.
Yeah, it could fit because if it talks about that, it could fit. And it could fit the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But the holistic thing is indicate about the truthfulness of Islam. As simple as that. The truthfulness of Islam. Then in that case, me and you, we have to study. If we know, if we believe that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the truth, that means we believe Islam. If we believe Kaaba and the Qibla and the Masjid al-Haram is the house of Allah established by Ibrahim alayhi salam, and we are obliged to follow and to pray to him, then we know Islam. If you know the truth, which is from Allah, all of it is about Islam. Then in that case, that's why there's where the difference of opinion between the Mufassirin. But these things for us, the tafsir, not necessarily, we are not like Christian. They don't dictate us what we should do, what we should accept.
It's an opinion.
It's opinion. That's how they think.
Okay.
And then they will use it to the best of their ability, especially because there is no text indicate that it is, for example, or to confirm that it is what they think. So that's why they say it could be according to the language, it could be.
Yeah,
the Masjid al-Haram. It could be according to the language. It could be about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Okay.
Could be about the Haqq, the truth.
Good.
Could be about
so
all of that.
Excellent.
Yeah.
That's very helpful. So given that it could be all of that, so what is there?
But not the Qibla.
The Qibla
is wrong. It's wrong way. The
Qibla is feminine. I get that. Given that grammatically it could be either. Again, why? So Ibn Kathir. How do you know Ibn Kathir is right on this?
The same thing. For us.
For us,
we could take a stand.
Okay.
To take, for example, okay, if that makes sense, if that goes with that, for example, for us as a student of knowledge, we'll check which one has more fame in terms of understanding. So the text, generally, for example, I go with if the verse is talking the closest noun, talking about it, that means this about the closest noun.
Which isn't Muhammad.
For example, I will go with that. And if it indicates the context sometimes, if the context,
right.
Talking about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then suddenly drifted.
It's all about the Qibla.
It does not matter for us. My
but
brother,
you're just saying that's the kind of thing.
It does not matter because we have one hadith, by the way, and related to this.
Is there a hadith on this?
As far as I remember, we have one hadith. But yes, we have one hadith.
Abdullah ibn Salam, I recognize.
Yeah, that's the one.
There's another one as well that Ibn Kathir mentions.
There's a hadith.
I'll check Ibn Kathir again.
This one.
Helpful.
It's the one by narrated by Atta bin Yasir. I met Abdullah bin Amr al-As.
Yeah. Where is that?
Is it Sahih?
See the Arabic one first, and then
it's not even Sahih.
You don't know the difference between a goat and a chicken, so I don't know how we'll understand Sahih.
Yeah, read.
146, yeah?
Yeah.
146,
yeah. So just go to Tafsir ibn Kathir, and it mentions that hadith.
Yeah, that's the hadith. Which one?
You came across this one before?
This is not Sahih.
How do you know?
Yeah. Read.
So hold on. Tell me about the description.
Read.
Okay.
It's in Al-Bukhari.
So Sahih Al-Bukhari.
It's in Sahih Al-Bukhari.
Narrated Atta ibn Yasir.
Yes.
I met Abdullah ibn Amr ibn Al-As.
Ibn As, yes.
And asked him, tell me about the description of the last messenger,
yes.
Which is mentioned in the Torah. He replied, yes, by Allah, he's described in the Torah with some of the qualities attributed to him in the Quran as follows.
Yes.
O Prophet, and I think this is a quote from the Quran. Oh, wait. Anyway. O Prophet, we have sent you as a witness and a giver of glad tidings. There's some things in brackets. I don't know if I should read those.
Yeah, continue.
That's okay. A good context.
We have sent you as a witness for Allah's true religion and a giver of glad tidings to the faithful believers and a warner to the disbelievers and to guardian of the illiterates. You are my slave and my messenger. I have named you Al-Mutawakkil, the one who depends upon Allah. You are neither discourteous, harsh, nor a noisemaker in the markets. And you do not do evil to those who do evil to you, but you deal with them with forgiveness and kindness. Allah will not let them, the Prophet, die till he makes straight the crooked path.
Yes.
The crooked people, by making them say, La ilaha illallah, none has the right to be worshipped but Allah, by which blind eyes, deaf ears, and closed hearts will be opened. So where's...
This is Bukhari, the reference given.
So the past, how do we know that's about 2146? Because that's specifically what I want to know.
Yeah, sure. So this is
that. Okay.
This is an app which you use.
Okay.
So this is Ayah 146, chapter 2.
Okay.
You press there, you look at the tafsir.
Okay. And this is, so whose tafsir is it?
Ibn Kathir. He's using
this. So Ibn Kathir connects these two.
Yeah. Right. He brought this to indicate
that,
about
that. That's not necessarily clear from the hadith, though. The hadith doesn't clarify.
No, he was asked about this verse. This Abdullah bin Amr bin As was asking about this verse, about the indication of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in there.
But it doesn't say anything about 2146, does it?
What is so that?
It could be about 7157 or 616. I mean, there are a number of verses which are about recognizing Muhammad.
Muhammad. So this is Ibn Kathir.
Caravan Raider.
I think we read the footnote earlier, which was for 242. So it's connecting. The footnote is connecting to this. And this is the one about Ibn Kathir.
So is that connecting or is Ibn Kathir connecting?
No, Ibn Kathir is this one, this ayah.
Because I don't have that. Let me get the Arabic one.
If you want to read that, it says here. So the Jews know that the Prophet is true,
but they hide the truth.
This is what Allah says.
What do you say? Those whom we gave the scripture, Jews and Christians, recognize him, Muhammad, or the Kaaba at Mecca.
Or
so
the
he
masjid.
Recognizes either as options, actually, doesn't he? So why can't it? Ibn Kathir, it could be either, right?
No, but it's saying either based on this ayah here. But what he's saying is that it gave the explanation why one is Muhammad and second why it could possibly also be Kaaba in this one over here.
Oh, why it can't be Kaaba?
Why it can't be Kaaba?
Okay, so he quotes that as being relevant to the verse.
Yes.
So this is relevant to verse 242. Which connects to this verse,
But is this even... Sorry, I'm confused, because that's Sahih International. That's a footnote, and that says Ibn Kathir.
So Sahih International is connecting the footnote.
Right, Sahih International is.
Yes.
You said Ibn Kathir, though, clarifies that this hadith is about that verse,
one second.
Right? And that's what I'm disputing.
Yeah, so if you read the whole thing in... the tafsir...
Listen.
Read the whole thing.
One second. Yeah. The verse before...
Here it is.
وَلَئِنْ أَتَيْتَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا
الْكِتَابَ
No, hold on a second.
Allah's messenger said.
One second.
So that's the other one. I'm aware of that one. Yes.
Listen. Here. Firstly, Allah said in the Quran, in the first one, قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ We see you're twisting your face in the heaven. فَلَنَوَلِّيَنَّكَ قِبْلَةً لَنْ تَرْضَاهَا We'll make you to turn your face towards the قبلة. فَوَلِّي وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ Turn your face towards the Masjid al-Haram, which is Mecca. Yeah? وَحَيْثُمَا كُنْتُمْ Wherever you are, then turn your face towards, which means in the direction of Kaaba. Yeah? شَطْرَة. وَأَنَّ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ And here, those who are being لَيَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّهُ الْحَقُّ They know that it is the truth from Allah. Yeah, one second.
So that would be about the Kaaba.
Now, we continue. أَنَّهُ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّهِ They know it's the truth from Allah عز وجل. وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ عَمَّا يَعْمَلُونَ One second. Now, again, continue. The following verse number 145.
Okay.
وَلَئِنْ أَتَيْتَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا مُحَمَّدْ If you come to the people of the book بِكُلِّ آيَةٍ With every verse Yeah مَا تَبِعُوا قِبْلَتَهُ They will not follow your direction وَمَا أَنْتَ بِتَابِعٍ قِبْلَتَهُ You will not follow their direction وَمَا بَعْضُهُمْ بِتَابِعٍ قِبْلَتَهُ And from amongst them they don't follow each other the Jews and the Christians وَلَئِنْ اتَّبَعْتَ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ If you follow their way their desire مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَكَ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ After the knowledge that come to you إِنَّكَ إِذًا لَمِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ You are from the transgressor The following verse this is 146 الَّذِينَ آتَيْنَاهُمُ الْكِتَابِ Those who has given the script يَعْرِفُونَهُ
They recognize it or him
No, here The first one One second Listen Here, the previous verse we finish about the Qibla, the Kaaba.
Yeah. Oh, we finished it. So that topic starts.
That's one second. Okay. That's where the tafsir comes in. That's
right.
Why I'm saying
it does.
The tafsir comes in. Now the context in the first in this verse, which is verse number 144, is talking about the Qibla, the direction of the Qibla and the Masjid al-Haram. Yes. And Allah is taking to us to follow the towards the direction of the Masjid al-Haram.
Yes.
And here they said it is the truth from Allah Azza wa Jal here, and the people of the book, they know, they recognize the truth or the Masjid al-Haram.
Yes.
Done?
Yeah, absolutely.
Next one, next verse.
Yeah.
Allah is talking to Muhammad now, addressing him. Oh Muhammad. If you go
where
to the people
say,
here, وَلَئِنْ أَتَيْتَ, Allah says here.
وَلَئِنْ
أَتَيْتَ, here, the verse number 145.
Okay.
The verse number 145, وَلَئِنْ أَتَيْتَ, if you come, you. So Allah is addressing who? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Okay, I see what you're saying. Yeah?
If you come, you Muhammad, if you come to the people of the book, yeah? If you brought to the people of the book with every single sign, with every true sign, every ayah, every verse, or every true sign, ما تبعوا قبلة, they will not follow your qibla.
Yes.
Which means the direction of the Kaaba, meaning they will not accept Islam, even if you brought them the truth, except if Allah guides them, of course. وما أنت بتعمل, and you will not follow their qibla, their direction. And even amongst them, they don't follow their direction. So Allah is talking about who now here? Allah is addressing the first person is Allah, the second person is Muhammad. Yeah? In this verse. وَلَيْنَ اتَّبَعْتَ أَهْوَاهُمْ. This 145, yeah? وَلَيْنَ اتَّبَعْتَ أَهْوَاهُمْ. And if you follow Muhammad, if you follow their desire, after the truth comes to you, from after the knowledge comes to you, here the Prophet is the one who got the knowledge, then you are from the transgressors. So Allah is warning him, if you did this, you're going to be from the transgressor. Then the following verse is talking about here. أَلَّذِينَ آتَيْنَهُمْ الْكِتَابِ. Those who has given the book. Yeah. يَعْرِفُونَهُ. They know it as they know. كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَا. As they know their sons. Yeah. As they know their sons. وَإِنَّ فَرِيقًا مِنْهُمْ لَيَكْتُمُونَ الْحَقِّ. And some of them, they will hide the truth. وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. While knowing. Now, here this verse, it has يَعْرِفُونَهُ. Either it's talking about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like they know their sons, or it's talking about the truth. Because here, the context of the ayah is talking about the truth.
And in the verses before and I think afterwards, what is the truth? It's the truth about the Qibla. Haq is used, not used before and after.
No, but Allah addresses him, remember?
Allah, now here, the second.
145.
Allah addresses the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because of that, under that context,
he's also the subject.
So it could be.
We say
there is no contradiction.
By the way, you know, Ibn Kathir also mentions Al Qurtubi with regards to Abdullah bin Salam, the one that you mentioned.
Yeah, Abdullah bin Salam.
Okay, here it is. According to Al Qurtubi, it was narrated that Umar said to Abdullah bin Salam, who was actually an Israelite scholar who became a Muslim, do you recognize Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as you recognize your own son? And he replies, yes, and even more.
Yes.
So there is clearly in
because
Ibn Kathir,
his wife may have cheated on him. It's a very funny story.
Well,
in some versions anyway.
Besides
who
the point.
Said that?
In the story, in some.
Yeah, even more.
Some
even more. Yes. That's what he means. That means he recognized the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than even his son. Yes. That's what he's saying.
Yeah.
And this is clearly showing you that Ibn Kathir mentions both with regards to the Kaaba and with regards to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Or the truth.
And does Ibn Kathir conclude which is best? Which is the best interpretation?
For example, I am in the first verse. For example, I am more inclined in the first verse to talk about the Masjid al-Haram, the Kaaba or the Masjid al-Haram. In the second one, which is to know they recognize by their like their own son, I'm more inclined to say about the Prophet because the context is talking about the Prophet. Allah is addressing him, and then after that, the people of the book they will recognize him.
You know, I'm spending all this time arguing about verse 146, but 144, 145, whichever one it was, you've conceded the people of the book recognize that the direction of prayer should be towards Al-Masjid al-Haram.
That's
so where's that in the Quran?
That's 144. That's 144. That's 144.
Yeah.
About, for example, the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam.
So would you
where's Ibrahim alayhi salam? Why? That's the question here. Why suddenly anything about Ishmael alayhi salam is disappeared from the Bible and the Torah?
Say again, why
anything about Ibrahim or his other son Ishmael is disappeared?
What's disappeared? I mean,
where is the story of Ishmael?
The
There's not much
about anything. What about Ishmael?
Well, I mean, you do have stories about Ishmael.
Like what?
Yeah, but very compared to the other prophets,
very less.
Yeah, yeah. You see the point.
I mean,
you see the point. So that's why my point is. It could be this. Could be that.
It could be that.
When they know that the one who built the Kaaba or the Darish or the Masjid al-Haram was Ibrahim alayhi salam and his son Ismail.
No.
So that's these are when you know this. And by the way, it was fought even from the early Christian, like the Abyssinian king, that they came to destroy Kaaba. So now here,
Abraham,
I will say to you,
Abraham was a Christian.
The king, the Abyssinian king.
Abraham was the one who occupied Yemen, who were actually Jewish, the Yemen Jewish. And then he wanted to occupy Kaaba.
I'm talking about him.
Abraham.
Okay.
He went to destroy Kaaba because he knew that it was the right thing. And the only thing, he wanted to destroy it in order to bring people to him. Okay. So the point
is... And
what
happened to him?
Destroyed by Allah.
Yes. What happened to the temple? The temple got destroyed, but the Kaaba never got destroyed.
So that's why...
The temple got destroyed twice.
We're saying to you, even the early Christian... They recognize this. They know this, but they wanted to twist the truth. So it's not this something. Is not something which is, you know, an incident.
So you
these things were kind of gradual.
I'm actually agreeing with a lot of your interpretation about what this meant at the time. My argument is that argument is actually very hard to hold historically.
Which one?
That means, so this gentleman, and I agree with you, and a lot of the tafsir, there's this idea that the Jews and the Christians at the time of Muhammad, they had clear descriptions of Muhammad, his attributes, his height, his hair color, the seal between his shoulders, that the direction of prayer should be towards al-Masjid al-Haram. All I'm saying is all the manuscripts we have of the New Testament, of the Old Testament, there's none of this. And that, I think, is the historic. So theologically, I agree with you. That's what the Quran is saying. That's what the tafsir says. Historically, I think
Isaiah 42, we gave you already.
Same thing. Can I say something?
I will add to this.
Same thing. Historically, or by text, you don't find Trinity anywhere in the Bible.
Exactly. Right.
You see the point?
Do you find Tawheed?
Yeah? How do you find it?
It's actually the first commandment.
I'm going to go.
Did you get the point? So if you don't find even the Trinity there, and yet people accept it worship as a truth.
Thank
you very much. I appreciate it.
Wish
we had more Christians like you and less like him.
Oh. Anyway, take care of yourself.
Thank God for that.
All right, thank you, brothers.
God bless you, brother. You have done very good.
Who is the Mike's?
I appreciate.
Let's go quiet.
First time I've come here.
Jazakallah khair. I don't know which one is which.
Yeah, they'll give it.
Which is which?
Others will sell it on.
Yeah.